Well, capitalism, socialism, conservatism, liberalism, what is it all? What are these isms here? William Baker on the line with us. Bill Baker, he is the author of a new book, Endless Money, The Moral Hazards of Socialism. Bill, welcome to the program.
Yeah, hi, thanks.
Hey, good to have you on. Your book, interestingly, you call for eliminating the income tax. If I get this right, going back to the gold standard. And a variety of other things. I'm curious, though, as a starting point, and I want to go through these, but as a starting point, first of all, you're not using the word socialist in the way that Karl Marx used it. You're using it more to describe Northern European-style democratic socialism, right? A welfare state.
Right.
Okay. And so my question to you is, why is it that the socialist states, the ones that you in your book argue were heading in that direction or that you decry very specifically, in fact, you're getting even into the so-called Obama agenda, why is it that the socialist countries have not experienced bank failures? Why is it that Germany's, you know, unemployment's never gone above 5.1% in this most recent recession? Why is it that that Canada has not had a single bank failure? The countries that have national health care programs, the countries where the government has intervened with strong socialist programs like unemployment insurance or co-paying employees to work part time, the countries that have had strong socialist programs like heavily regulating the banking industry, they're not experiencing the crisis that we are here with the pseudo libertarianism we've experienced.
Well, for one, at the end of the first year of the crisis, 2008, the Federal Reserve expanded its balance sheet very dramatically, and what happened was the largest item of support. You can look it up on their website. Was a category called other.
Mm-hmm.
And other, basically, if you read the footnotes, says these are basically transfers of support for other government central banks.
Right.
So we propped up Europe. We propped up everything else. I do agree with you. Canada has done a much better job. They've had a more probably a more tightly regulated financial system.
Well, the Bank of England also expanded the balance sheet, which is causing consternation in the UK. But we really don't know what that other is.
Yeah.
I mean, this is one of the reasons why socialists like Bernie Sanders and libertarians like Ron Paul are calling for an audit of the Fed.
Good idea.
Yeah, I agree with you, and I share your skepticism of the Fed. You call for an end of the income tax. And yet, the only periods of stability in the United States, we had from the founding of this country, from the founding of the Republic, until the 19-teens, at least every 15 years, and typically every 8 to 12 years, there was a major financial panic. Literally from the founding of the country, I'm sure you're familiar with this as an economist.
Yeah. No, I'm a student of it. Yeah.
And it wasn't until we instituted an income tax that those panics stopped. And whenever the income tax in the United States has been above 50%, and look at the numbers and look at the years, you can verify this. Whenever the income tax is above 50% on people making more than the top 1%, which would be $384,000 a year right now, but typically on millionaires and billionaires, whenever the income tax is above 50%, we do not have bank panics, we do not have stock market crashes. Every time the income tax drops below 50%, we go back into those 12 and 15 year cycles, which we're in right now. So why would you want to do away with this great stabilizer?
Well, I'm not sure that that's really true. If you go back to the biggest panic of our modern era was 1929, and in 1929
right.
The income tax was
21%. It was dropped from 91% in 1920 by President or 21 by Harding when he came in. It was at 91% after World War I, and he dropped it down to 26%. And by the time, and then the Coolidge administration and the Hoover administration, they dropped it down to 20%. The top maximum that was the maximum marginal tax rate.
Well,
what Roosevelt took it back up to 91%, and all of a sudden things got stabilized, and they were stabilized through the Roosevelt administration, the Truman administration, the Eisenhower administration, a good Republican who was no socialist who thought the 91% tax rate was a good thing, through the Eisenhower administration, through the Kennedy administration, through the Nixon administration, through the Johnson administration. Johnson dropped it down to 74%. It was still above 50%. Our economy remained stable through the Johnson administration, through the Carter administration. We didn't have a panic. We had inflation, but we didn't have a panic. Reagan comes in, he drops it back down below 50% into the 20s, and boom, within 14 months, you had the great crash of 87.
You know, I don't think there's a cause and effect there. I think the cause and effect is more with the Federal Reserve and with the banking system in general.
But the Fed was jacking rates up and down throughout that period of time. I mean, Fed, for example, look at the end of the 70s, you know, when the Fed jacked interest rates up to try and wring out inflation during the Carter era, which was
Let's take it to the very beginning, okay? Hmm. The first time you had massive urban unemployment was after the crisis of 1819. And
yes,
that was caused by an excess of credit. And we started to have banks and bank credit beginning in the very early part of the 19th century.
Well, we had the first bank of the United States, which went out of business around that time.
That's right.
We had the second bank of the United States, which went out of business, Andrew Jackson campaigned on putting that out. So that would be the 1830s, was it? 1836
that's right.
Or something like that?
And the reason why he vetoed it was because these banks were creating all this credit, and the credit was a substitute for the real money,
right,
and it pumped up real estate prices, and people, seeing these ever-rising prices, chased it and got further into debt.
Well, let me just...
And they got in over their heads.
You're right.
And
there is moral hazard there. I'm agreeing with you.
Right.
We're talking with William Baker, conservativeeconomist.com, his website, and his book, The Endless Money, The Moral Hazards of Socialism. But what I don't get here is how you can conflate having a Federal Reserve Bank, which I think should be brought under the Treasury. I think that we should buy the thing. We should nationalize the Fed. The Constitution explicitly says that we're supposed to mint our own money, and unfortunately, the Treasury Department only issues coins. You know, the bills are issued, as you know, by the Fed. How can you conflate the existence of a private Federal Reserve Bank with socialism? If anything, it's the opposite. The Fed is super libertarian. It's a private institution.
Well, it's not libertarian. Libertarians hate the Fed.
I know, but they say that things should be done by private institutions, not by government, and the Fed is a private institution.
Basically, the Fed increases credit exponentially.
Yes.
And it increases the money supply exponentially, which causes
and occasionally decreases it to go up. Right, and occasionally decreases as it did in 1930.
Private individuals cause that decrease. Private individuals, whenever they pay down debt or they go bankrupt, causes the money supply to shrink.
Right. But the Fed was not helping. I mean, in the early
1930s. Actually, that's not true either. The Fed was very expansionary, and that's one of the misrepresentations in Milton Friedman's work. It's very thoroughly documented.
Well, in
by,
any case,
Murray Rothbard.
How you know, what does that have to do with socialism? We have a minute left, by the way. I don't get it.
Okay, a minute. Well, basically, I associate the Fed with. You know, big government, big statism, control of the money. No, but it's the government controlling it, because the government appoints all the governors, and the government is in.
But don't you want the government to control our money supply? I mean, isn't that the definition of the gold standard?
Well, I didn't say to you that I was in favor of gold standard. You said that. I think that we're headed that way. I think central banks realize that gold is a better way to go. But I would encourage individuals to be using gold the way it was in the olden days.
Yeah.
Well,
that's kind of a grim prognosis for the dollar. William Baker, conservativeeconomist.com is his website, his book, Endless Money, The Moral Hazards of Socialism. Interesting conversation, Bill. Thanks for dropping
by. Yeah,
we're
not that far apart in many ways.
I suspect you're right. Thanks.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Good talking
with
you.
Thank you.